Hi. My name is Glenn Alexander Thompson. So that you can see me, I have placed a photograph of myself on the bottom left of the screen. My natural voice is a slow Aussie drawl, so I am using a faster computer-generated voice for narration. In this video, I am going to demonstrate one clear instance of overt, crass, and flagrant, court-based fraud by the Victorian-based, now federal court judge, Justice John Middleton. I will also demonstrate that Middleton is a protected, overtly corrupt, fraudster. The question Victorians will have to ask themselves is, how many hundreds, perhaps thousands, of Victorians, possibly including defenseless little old widows and struggling single mothers, were defrauded by that now purportedly honorable, in fact fraudster, judge? Now, my viewers, before I start, on the 12th of February 2019, sufficient detail of all of the following crass court-based fraud and corruption was placed squarely under the nose of the present Chief Justice of Victoria and the President of the Court of Appeal. Predictably, they have done nothing. On the face of it, because their silence and inaction is assured, they, and other judges of their ilk, are squarely at the root of the court-based fraud and corruption which I describe in this video. Okay, now I will get to the detail of Middleton's fraud. On the screen now is 7 plans of subdivision. Count them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, now that's fairly simple. Manifestly, there are 7 separate, distinct, unique, discrete, plans of subdivision. Now, the reason that I have just gone through that apparently mindless exercise of counting those plans is that Macedon Ranges Shire Council and its executive were involved in very serious property fraud and court fraud, which involved those plans. Then, for the purpose of concealing that property fraud, in 3 separate Victorian courts, the council and its executive and its lawyers falsified documents and committed perjury, which represented that those 7 plans were merely parts of a single plan of subdivision. In other words, the council and its executive and its lawyers told 3 separate judges that those 7 plans of subdivision were, or constituted, one single plan of subdivision. They also told the judges that those 7 plans of subdivision related to and created one single 18 allotment subdivision. Now, the important thing is that 2 of the judges believed, or at least accepted, those palpably false and perjurious representations by the council. The 3rd court proceeding was settled before the judge was required to make judgment, so we'll never know if the 3rd judge was also deceived. However, the important thing is that, on that 3rd occasion, the counsel and its lawyers intended to also deceive the 3rd judge. Now, the issue here is that property fraud by the counsel and its executive caused me several millions of dollars in loss and damage. The 3rd proceeding was where I sued the counsel for my loss and damage. Now, at that time, while I knew full well that the plans were 7 separate plans which created 7 separate subdivisions, I could not show, much less prove, that the mind and belief of the counsel was other than that which its documentary and sworn evidence represented. In other words, I could not show that the counsel and its executive and its lawyers were committing fraud in and on the court. So, in that 3rd court case, all I could do was to allege that the counsel had acted with innocent mistake of law. Now, at that time my lawyers advised me that courts will not, or are at least unlikely to, award damages which were caused by an innocent mistake of law. So on that occasion, and in those circumstances, the counsel offered me a settlement which represented a small portion of my total losses and consequential damage. I accepted because if I refused that offer and persisted with my full claim, I would become liable to pay all further costs if I was unsuccessful in my full claim. At that time, terms of settlement and a deed of release was signed. So, at that time the counsel and its executive and its lawyers knew full well that by committing perjury and falsifying documents they had effectively defrauded me out of my then full claim. Okay, so that's the background. Now, in the year 2000, I discovered evidence which demonstrated that the counsel had falsified documents and committed perjury in the 3 earlier courts. I, therefore, started a new Supreme Court proceeding to recover my loss and damage which the counsel had fraudulently avoided paying in the earlier proceeding. That new proceeding alleged serious deliberate misconduct by the counsel. Now, to succeed in that new proceeding, I had to show and prove that the foundation of my new case had been fraudulently concealed by the counsel at the time of my earlier proceeding. That was easy, as I have already discussed. All I had to do was to demonstrate that in the 3 earlier proceedings the counsel falsified documents and committed perjury to conceal its true knowledge and belief, namely, the obvious fact that the 7 plans were separate and discrete plans which related to and created 7 separate and discrete subdivisions. Now, to cut a long story short, through a friend, an acquaintance solicitor became aware of my intention to sue the counsel for a very substantial amount. That acquaintance solicitor offered to act for me without fee but instead in return for a cut of the substantial damages payment expected to be received by me. I accepted that offer. Now my viewers, listen closely, this next part is important. My advice to those solicitors was that the foundation of my new case was that I had discovered evidence that in the three earlier proceedings the counsel had committed perjury and falsified documents, to conceal, from the courts and me, the fact that it had processed the seven plans as seven separate and discrete plans and subdivisions. In other words, the foundation of my new case was that, in the three earlier proceedings, the counsel had concealed its true mind and belief from the courts and from me. Incredibly, unbeknown to me, those solicitors mistakenly understood that the foundation of my new case was that the fraud of the counsel had caused me to believe that the seven plans were parts of a single plan, and caused me to believe that the seven subdivisions were parts of a single subdivision. Now, the seriousness of that misunderstanding cannot be overstated. The Victorian law was very clear. At law, the foundation of my new case had to have been concealed from me by fraud by the counsel, and I could not have discovered that foundation by exercising reasonable diligence. Now, it is manifestly obvious that the fact that the seven plans were seven disparate and discrete plans giving rise to seven disparate and discrete subdivisions could not be concealed at all, let alone by fraud. So those solicitors knew full well that my case, as misunderstood by them, had essentially zero chance of succeeding, and they should have told me so, but they did not. So, unbeknown to me, those solicitors were intending to represent to the court that I was a nincompoop who could not with reasonable diligence know or learn that the seven plans were seven separate and discrete plans and that the seven subdivisions were seven separate and discrete subdivision. Manifestly, those lawyers were engaged in a scheme where in the one in a thousand chance they could successfully make that patently fallacious case they would get more than $1 million, and if they failed I would be the sucker who was left to pay the counsel's substantial court costs. Those solicitors were on a seriously good for them, no risk scam. Those solicitors engaged the then Victorian barrister, John Middleton, to put their fallacious case to the court. The hearing came on in 2005, I was absent from the court for most of the 2 days of hearing. I therefore ordered a transcript so I could enjoy the details of the trouncing which I expected Middleton to deliver to the counsel. I was shocked to discover the flat-out false, fabricated and fraudulent submissions put by Middleton. On the screen now is a representative extract from the transcript where Middleton falsely and fraudulently represented that the counsel had led me to believe that the seven plans represented sections of a single plan and that there were several sections or parts of a single subdivision. An extract from the next page of the transcript is on the screen now, and as you can see, Middleton represented that I was a nincompoop, a little slow of mind, and that the fact that there are seven discrete plans and seven discrete subdivisions took a little while to sink into my dim-witted brain. I immediately wrote to Middleton and copied that letter to my solicitors. In my letter, I stated the self-evident which is on the screen now. As you can see, I said, a plan of subdivision is plainly just that, a plan which relates to a subdivision. One plan equals one subdivision. Two plans equals two subdivisions, etc. I do not know of anyone so moronic as to think seven plans equals one subdivision, as you submitted of me at pages 44 and 45 of the Day 2 transcript. I then said what's on the screen now. In essence, I said that failure of my case is assured and that the thing said by him could not be said to be concealed or even concealable. I repeated that on his submission I must and should fail. I then required Middleton to immediately refund all money paid to him. I then required him to undertake to assist to the extent necessary to rectify the damage done by him. Middleton replied by letter dated 17th of February 2006. He denied the things which I just pointed out. He subsequently refused to refund his fraudulently obtained fees of $86,000, and he refused to assist me to undo the damage done by him. I shouldn't be surprised, he is obviously an accomplished, flagrant fraudster, devoid of moral compass and with powerful people protecting him. Now, manifestly, prior to incurring his $86,000 fee, Middleton should have advised me that my case, as understood by him, had essentially zero chance of success, but he did not. Manifestly, Middleton's eye was on my wallet and morality was out the window. That was a classic case of a lawyer using the court as a tool of fraud to enrich himself. 3 months later, now Associate Justice F. Team, published his reasons for decision. The result was exactly as anticipated by me. Associate Justice F. Team found that nothing had been concealed from me and ordered that my claim be dismissed. I appealed. My appeal came on before Justice Robert Osborn. My written appeal submission very accurately stated and evinced that Middleton had misrepresented me in the facts and the law. I said that the things which Middleton represented to have been concealed from me were, not only not concealed. They were not concealable. Now my viewers, listen closely, I will now demonstrate that Victorian judges commit such further fraud as is necessary to conceal the fraud and corruption of their mates. Now, Osborn published his reasons for judgment on 29 November 2006. At paragraphs 4, 5, and 6 of his purported reasons for judgment, for the purpose of concealing Middleton's fraud, Osborn exactly repeated and represented as fact the perjury which the counsel used to deceive me in the earlier three courts. By doing so, he concealed the true foundation of my proceeding. I will show Osborn's fabricated paragraph shortly. First, I will describe and demonstrate the overt criminal corruption of the counsel which Osborn was concealing. Now, back then, in the 1980s, it was illegal to sell an allotment on a subdivision consisting of three or more allotments until such time as the Registrar of Titles had approved the plans of subdivision. In turn, the Registrar of Titles was prevented from approving such subdivisions until all council-required infrastructures such as roads and water supply were complete. Now the council's solicitors, Palmer Stevens and Rennick, and the council executive were involved in several schemes to facilitate avoidance of those laws. In this particular case, the council's solicitors had illegally sold at least two of the allotments by contracts dated 7 February 1980. At that time, no plan of subdivision had been filed with the council, let alone approved by the Registrar of Titles. Now the scheme to legitimize those illegal sales was as follows. Firstly, the law required a plan of subdivision to show all roads and allotments intended to be set out. So, a legitimate plan of subdivision, showing all 18 allotments intended to be set out, was filed with the council on 12 February 1980. The Shire Engineer referred the legitimate plan to the council on 20 February 1980. The council approved that plan and resolved to require the developer to construct the roads and water supply shown on that plan. The Shire Engineer then did not refer the plan to the various statutory authorities which the law required him to refer it to. The Shire Engineer then destroyed that plan and the entire council file related to that plan. Then on the 4th of March 1980, the developer separately filed each of the seven plans of subdivision which I discussed earlier. Now, those plans were filed with the Shire Engineer and Shire Secretary, as distinct from the council. Now, each of those seven plans was manifestly in breach of the law which required a plan to show all roads and allotments intended to be set out. In addition, six of those seven manifestly unlawful plans were fraudulently contrived two-lot plans of subdivision, that were contrived to facilitate avoidance of the law which prevented the sale of allotments on plans of subdivision consisting of three or more allotments. In breach of the law, the Shire Engineer did not refer any one of those seven plans to the council for approval. He did, however, separately refer each of the seven plans to the various statutory authorities which the law required him to refer plans to. So by this point, the Shire Engineer had referred the legitimate plan to the council but did not refer it to the various other statutory authorities, and he had destroyed the legitimate plan and associated council file. Additionally, he did not refer any one of the seven plans to the council but did separately refer each of them to the various statutory authorities. Then by his engineer's report of 21 March 1980, the Shire Engineer fraudulently represented to the council that the single legitimate plan of subdivision, which they had approved, on 20 February, had been filed in seven parts. The Shire Engineer then recommended that the council seal each of those supposed seven parts of the in fact destroyed legitimate plan. The ignorant and compliant councillors then dutifully resolved to separately seal each of those seven plans. By that process, the Shire Executive duped the councillors into sealing plans of subdivision which had no planning permit, and which the council had not approved, and which had no roads or water supply, and where there was no lawful means of compelling anyone to provide that necessary infrastructure. The solicitors, Palmer Stevens and Rennick, then separately filed each of those sealed plans with the titles office. Then, in full knowledge that the necessary infrastructure had not been constructed, the Shire Secretary, Stan Porter, falsely advised the titles office that the developer had complied with the in fact non-existent council requirement that he construct the necessary roads and water supply. Then, in full knowledge that each of those plans of subdivision was in breach of the law which required plans to show all roads and allotments intended to be set out, an officer of the Victorian Land Titles Office approved each of those plans of subdivision on the same day as each other. From that point, the solicitors, Palmer Stevens and Rennick, could and did sell allotments which had no necessary infrastructure, and where there was no lawful means of the council compelling anyone to provide that infrastructure. Now, as a direct consequence of the foregoing overt fraud and corruption, and that I had purchased some of the allotments shown on those plans, the council and I ended up facing each other in three consecutive court proceedings. Now, in such proceedings, both sides have to exhibit their relevant documents. Now in those three court proceedings, the council could not exhibit the legitimate 18-lot plan which the council had approved and the Shire Engineer had then destroyed. So, the council perjuriously exhibited the in fact locality plan which is on the screen now. The council then committed further perjury by representing that plan to be the plan of subdivision which the council had considered, and approved, and made resolutions in respect of, on 20th February 1980. The council then committed further perjury by representing that each of the seven plans of subdivision were parts of that in fact locality plan. By making those overtly perjurious representations, the council fraudulently represented, to me and the court, that the council resolutions, purportedly made in respect of the in fact locality plan, flowed to and were valid or effective in respect of each of the seven in fact illegal plans which the council, in fact, never considered. In other words, the council perjuriously represented that the council's resolution that the developer construct the necessary infrastructure shown on the in fact locality plan imposed a duty to construct the roads and water supply shown on each of the seven plans. Okay, now I go back to Justice Robert Osborn's crass fraud. On the screen now is paragraphs 4, 5, and 6 of Osborn's purported, but in fact, purposefully fabricated, reasons for judgment. Now, at his paragraph 4, Osborn wrongly states that on 20th February 1980 the council resolved to seal the plans which it considered on that day. However, in that paragraph, Osborn accurately says that the council resolved to impose requirements that the developer construct the roads and water supply shown on the plan which it considered on 20th February 1980. Then at his paragraph 5, Osborn overtly fraudulently represents that the developer then submitted the seven plans for approval by the council. Also at his paragraph 5, Osborn further purposefully falsely represents that the seven plans were in effect stages of the previously proposed subdivisions. So, at his paragraph 5, Osborn knowingly and purposefully repeated and represented as fact what he knew to be the perjury of the council in the three earlier proceedings. The fact known to Osborn was that in conspiracy with the council executive the subdivider submitted the seven plans in such a manner and for the specific purpose of completely bypassing the council approval process. Osborn was also well aware that the council never did either consider or approve any one of those seven plans. Osborn was also well aware that the seven plans were not stages or parts of the legitimate plan which the Shire engineer had purposefully destroyed and therefore was not in evidence before either him or the three earlier courts. Then at his paragraph 6, Osborn fraudulently represented that the seven plans were endorsed as subject to the roadmaking requirement which the council had resolved to impose with respect to the legitimate plan which the council did consider on 20th February 1980. At the time of writing his paragraph 6, Osborn was well aware that he was exactly repeating the fraud and perjury of the council and its executive and its lawyers in each of the three earlier proceedings. Osborn was well aware that the entire purpose of the falsified documents and perjury of the council and its executive and its lawyers in the three earlier courts was to fraudulently represent that the roadmaking requirements which the council imposed in respect of the in fact non-existent, destroyed plan, flowed to and were imposed in respect of each of the seven plans and seven subdivisions. Osborn was well aware that the so-called global plan referred to in his paragraph 6 had been destroyed and that the in fact locality plan was the so-called global plan in evidence before him. So, by those three paragraphs, Osborn exactly restated and represented as fact what he knew to be the fraudulent representations which the council made in its fabricated documents and sworn evidence in the three earlier proceedings. Now, just a few closing but very serious comments. Now, as discussed earlier in this video, I sent a letter to Middleton and my solicitors. In that letter, in no uncertain manner, I set out the fact that Middleton had absolutely misrepresented me. That letter prompted written communication between Middleton and my solicitors. Now, on the screen now is the header of one of those letters, and as you can see it is addressed to Middleton. That letter was sent shortly after Associate Justice Efteen published his reasons and order that I pay punishing indemnity costs for having brought a baseless case. Now, the final two paragraphs of that letter are on the screen now. Now, the first part of the first of those paragraphs refers to the fact that punishing costs orders were made against me, and then in the part underlined in red my solicitors told Middleton that the solicitors for the council intend to make an application to the Supreme Court for an order that my solicitors pay those punishing indemnity costs instead of me. Then underlined in blue my solicitors told Middleton that the reason why the council's solicitor was going to make that application was that the case put by Middleton had no prospect of success and should never have been brought before the court. So, the critical point here is that the solicitors for the council were well aware that Middleton had put a scam and sham case. Now, at that time, I had not yet appealed to Osborn, so at that time the solicitors for the council would hold the opinion that I was an ignorant layperson and that Middleton had wrongly acted on my hopeless instructions. However, after I filed my notice of appeal and my written submissions to Osborn, those solicitors knew well that Middleton had not acted according to my instructions. So the critical point here is that those solicitors knew well that Osborn had fabricated his reasons to conceal Middleton's fraud and misconduct, which they themselves had identified as wrongful. So the unavoidable conclusion is that the presiding judge, the now Associate Justice F team, and all of the opposing solicitors, whose photographs are on the screen now, each knew well that Middleton had put a case which had zero chance of success. It follows that Associate Justice F team and each of those solicitors knew well, or had a strong cause of belief, that Middleton was using the court as a tool of fraud to scam me of his fees. Yet they each did and said nothing. Then at the appeal before Osborn, each of those solicitors knew well that Osborn had fabricated his purported reasons and that the effect of that fabrication was to deny and conceal the conduct of Middleton, which I alleged and evinced before Osborn. Now, the manifest fact is that the crooked lawyers, such as Middleton, conduct their fraud in full view of their fellow lawyers and whichever judge is allocated to hear their sham cases. Similarly, the crooked judges, such as Osborn, fearlessly conduct their fraud in full view of each and every one of their fellow judges. Manifestly they do so in the sure knowledge that not one of their fellow judges has either the courage, honor or integrity to stand up and expose them. I am going to bring the charade of the Victorian so-called justice system to a grinding halt. I am going to force reform of the so-called justice system. Interested viewers should like and share this video and also subscribe to my YouTube channel. I have many more exposés coming. Now, at the end of this video, I have provided a link to the conduct of the Victorian Court of Appeal when it concealed Osborne's fraud. A link to that video and support documents for this video is also in the comments section of this video. The end. We shall see.